been married for quite a while. Got a bunch of kids doing faith in style. They'll tell you that you're awesome and you're not alone.
So let's start the show.
Who knew Catholics could be so much fun? Greg and Jennifer and how faith is done. Screwing up and trying and forgiving. Adventures in imperfect living. Adventures in imperfect living.
Greetings, folks. I'm Greg Willits from GregandJennifer.com and RosaryArmy.com.
And I'm Jennifer Willits, his wife.
Coming up on episode 331 of Adventures in Imperfect Living,
we talk about what to do with all these live rosary streams on our YouTube channel.
The challenges of going back to Mass.
We also wonder, where has our reverence gone?
And we have an interview with our friend Jason Taylor about an amazing Catholic conference online for kids that's happening this weekend. If you have youngsters, or even if you don't, you just like cool Catholic media, you're going to want to listen to this. All this and more coming up, episode 331. It's starting right now. Don't forget, as always, while you're listening, look down at your phone. You see chapters and images, and even in certain podcast listening devices, you can see the links to the things that we talk about on the show. And also, thanks to our co-producers and other supporters over patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. Thank you so much to all of you who have continued to support us. You can get swag in the mail for $10 a month supporters. $5 a month will get you access to our monthly meetups, all sorts of bonus content that we've published over the years, over 100 different pieces of audio content exclusive to our co-producers, available right now, patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. So this week, we're going to be praying the Rosary live on Rosary Army's YouTube channel. Again, youtube.com/Rosary Army is the address of the channel. And here it is, you know, as we're recording this, it's the middle of June. Back in March, middle of March, is when we made the decision that we would live stream the Rosary as the pandemic thing was starting, right? So March, April, May, June, 3 months now, we've been praying Rosary. And when we started this, literally thought that we would be doing it for a couple of weeks. Everyone's saying, okay, we need 2 weeks to sort of gauge where we're at. Everyone just sort of needs to, you know, start self-isolating for a couple of weeks and let's figure this out. And then, so in my mind, I just kept having 2 weeks in my head. And suddenly here it is 3 months later and we're still doing it. And what's interesting is as soon as we started doing it in the community that started to build up, at the very beginning of it, people were saying, you know, I really hope that you'll continue doing this even after the pandemic is over. And when people start saying that, already it's sort of like, okay, when you sign up to do something, you don't, and I've talked about this, even like, you know, doing stuff at church, right? Where they want you to take part in a class or lead some apostolate or something like that, that I'm just the kind of person who I hesitate to sign up for anything if it's going to be long-term, because I just don't know if mentally I'm going to be able to commit to it that long. And so with praying the rosary every night, again, I like the idea of going along, but what's been happening, and listen, I'll ask for your prayers about this. It's a weird challenge for me to show up every night and lead the rosary and sort of be expected to be there. You know, that's a new commitment. 8 o'clock, Monday through Thursday, be there. And I say this not complaining at all. Please don't take this as a complaint. It's me just simply going, okay, I thought I was going to do this for 2 weeks, and now 3 months later, I'm still doing it. Is this a new normal for my life? Is this something that I just need to say, you know what? This is something that I do, that every night, until God stops it, we're going to do this. And when do I know when God has stopped it? You know, that kind of thing. It's like, how do I know?
Because, will God ever get tired of it?
Well, no, he'll never get tired of us praying the rosary. But listen, there's a lot of other resources, including live rosary, you know, groups.
By bigger organizations
yeah, where there's a lot of people showing up, and there's a lot more people that are praying together at one time than there is on our rosary.
But I will say what I think makes our live stream rosary different when you compare us up against the Rosary Crusade COVID-19 prayer that has thousands of subscribers, or even the one that the Vatican does, you know, is that we have the intimate approach. It's a husband and a wife literally sitting down in a room in their house. And I think that is where we shine a little bit. I mean, I'm not trying to, in all humility here, I'm just saying.
It's the differentiating factor. It's not shining, but
it's right. It's the difference from just going to a little coffee house down the street, sitting on comfy chairs with your friends, having a conversation up against a very large, you know, arena style meeting where it doesn't feel as intimate or as personal just because of the way that the production was meant to be large scale. And I think there is room for both style of rosary praying productions. I personally like it. I understand the
challenges. Like it too. I like it too, but it is a mental challenge, right?
Yes.
And we know how well Greg handles mental challenges in recent years. And right. So this is something that I sit there and I go, I mean, so for example, this has definitely, doing the live stream, definitely played a part in the delay of Rosary Army's website. No doubt about it in my mind that this 3 months of praying the rosary at night at 8 o'clock has had an impact on my ability to get the website done. Because we're doing it at 8, which means we're praying until, you know, we're doing stuff until 9 with it. And then I can't just go straight to bed. And then it almost like it resets the clock in a weird way that we're then awake for even longer. And we're staying up later than we ever have in our entire marriage. I mean, we're up until midnight most nights. And that's just really weird for us. Well, if we're up till midnight, then we're going to sleep until 8 or 9, you know, or whatever it is, because we wake up a zillion times in the middle of the night. And so it's had an impact. And the other thing that I look at is that we currently have right now about 50 people, 50 plus people, 50 to 60 people showing up every night.
These are the diehard regulars.
Diehard. And, and these are the ones who are like, you know, we really hope that you'll keep praying. And they have been so wonderful. These people, I can't stress it enough how dedicated and wonderful these people have been that show up and how committed they are and how supportive they are and how much they're praying for us as individuals and us as a couple and for the Rosary Army Apostolate. And so you need a core group of people like that for any successful religious initiative to succeed. And so that probably is the biggest thing, is like if Rosary Army is to grow and succeed, and here's this apostolate that's been going on for 17 years, chugging along, that's kind of like the where I kind of struggle is like, okay, when we first started this at one point, you know, we had over 300 people joining us for the rosary, and then it slipped down after that first week. And then the average for a while was about 100. But in the last month is where it dipped down to about 50 to 60. And so it's like, you know, seeing a 50% drop in participation over the course of a month. And last week I mentioned, you know, we mentioned this one night when we were doing the live rosary that kind of struggling. I'm not struggling to do it. I'm questioning a lot of stuff. I want to make sure that am I putting my time where it's supposed to be? Am I putting my energy where it's supposed to be? Because I think we both want to keep doing it. But I'm asking the question, is this the most prudent way to spend my limited work and mental resources? Is this really what God wants? And so it's hard for me to pray and look for a concrete answer. I don't know, even if I do pray for clarity, I don't know what it would look like when I was given clarity, other than some supernatural infusion of a desire to do this, right? And so our plan is to keep doing it, to keep going forward. But like, then I stop and think, and you know, you brought up scripture, right? I stop and think, okay, well, what happens if it drops another 50% in the next month, and now we're down to 25 people showing up? And all the work that we're doing every night for 25 people, to me, I'm like, well, we have the Rosary Army app if they really want to pray with us. If they, you know, they could by that point, they could start up their own groups and do this. And so those are the kinds of questions I have. Now, I bring all this up because we got a really nice email from co-producer Vince. And he says, my wife Liz and I want to thank you guys for praying the rosary and letting us be a part of the Rosary Army community. We are grateful to Jesus and the Blessed Mother who led us to the Rosary Army. Praying with everyone has really made us stronger in faith and given us courage and guidance through this pandemic. Even though everything seems crazy in this world right now, the rosary brings us joy, and I believe the rosary will see us through this. Liz is currently working from home, and I work 8 to 4. We managed to make dinner, feed the family, and walk our dog before 8 p.m. 8 p.m. Monday through Thursday works good for us. And he's talking about in terms of praying the rosary. We understand if times and days have to be changed as people go back to work, and I'm sure we can make it work if times do change. And so again, it's like, well, this is something that we were doing during the pandemic, right? I mean, businesses changed their working hours. People added new things. People, you know, John Krasinski did only 8 episodes. We've prayed the rosary like 100 times, you know, in the last 3 months. And so it's things like that that's sort of like, okay, I want to do the right thing. I'm just not sure what the right thing is right now. And that's really what I'm struggling with. I'm not struggling with praying the rosary and doing the live stream. If this is part of the future of Rosary Army, then we'll keep doing it. Then we'll keep pushing forward and doing that. But I also think it's like, well, if we weren't doing that kind of production, we'd be doing something else that might have more longevity or more service to more people kind of thing.
Now, obviously, we didn't have a chance to really discuss this before we started recording the show, but I will throw this out.
Well, that's why we have these discussions a lot of times, so that you know this spontaneous conversation is oftentimes where we get the solutions.
I think it's completely reasonable to expect that the live rosary Monday through Thursday will probably even be further reduced as more other organizations return and reopen and people start resuming some version of a normal kind of life, although I don't think anything will really be 100% back to the way that it was before COVID-19 came into our life. But what we have learned for sure was there is great value in praying this rosary live. We didn't know that before. Now we have learned that there is...
Well, that's not entirely true.
To pray it live,
yeah, because
on
YouTube? We did it on Ustream 12 or 13 years ago on occasion. And we would have 100 people showing up even back then. And that was kind of nice. We didn't quite do it the exact same way we do now, where we're doing everyone's prayer requests and that kind of thing. But we have done it before. But memory, I think, gets fuzzy. But this is on YouTube. Yes, it's very different.
I would propose that and I don't know when we could potentially start this, but I'm thinking that maybe, I know right now we're not praying anything on the weekends, that we have specifically blocked that off of our time to rest and all that. But what if we prayed a live rosary on the first Saturday of the month to sort of coincide with that Marian tradition from Our Lady of Fatima, that day would work with that that request that Our Lady had on us to increase our devotion, because we definitely need more devotion and holiness in our everyday private lives. You know, we need to be doing what we can. So if we lead a rosary on that day, it kind of, you know, knocks off a lot of, checks off a lot of things in one shot. You know, it's a lot of bang for your spiritual buck if you move it over to that day, only the first Saturday of the month. So that's one guaranteed possible recording time that we could pray the rosary live. And then maybe always on a Marian feast day, you know, those are live rosaries. It's like a cause for celebration. Let's come together and pray a rosary in honor of something for Mary. And so Rosary Army can pick and choose very, you know, specifically dates as an excuse to pray. So that's one idea. And then...
Okay. Are you about to explain a different idea?
Well, the only other day I would suggest is on Sundays, because that's a day, that's the Sabbath day, and people have, I believe that many people have fallen away from the practice of keeping that day holy as a Sabbath day. And they don't know what to do. They're like, but I just want to be on the internet. I just want to play games. I just want to watch TV all day because it's Sunday. I already went to church. You know, it's like, well, what else can you do? So maybe if we push like on occasional Sundays, well, then there's something good and holy that you can do on a Sunday. And then the week is more designed for work, productivity. And then we stay off of the Monday through Friday so that you can have those heavy production hours. Those are just some preliminary ideas that were coming to my head.
So a few responses to that.
Sure.
if we went to where we're praying on doing the live stream rosary on Saturday and Sunday, then that would go back to make me feel like, well, I never have a day off ever. Right. Mm-hmm. And, gotcha. And Sunday would not be a day of rest for me. Then it would be something I'd be revolving around the rosary, because I can't help but think about, okay, what's going to have to be done and what emails need to be sent out? What social media do I have to do to remind people that those things, you know, so
that's always marketing.
That's work. Mm-hmm. You know, that's all work. So having said that, I'm not opposed to doing that, but then there's going to be a cost during the week of me needing to have time off during the week to make sense. So again, knowing that there's all these other resources that are available, is that what you and I need to be doing? Because again, if we do it and still we only have 50 people showing up, is it, and listen, there's nothing stopping anyone from praying the rosary. We're not providing anything that someone is not already capable of having. We're just providing something extra for people to benefit from. It's sort of like going from listening to music on earbuds to listening with sound canceling headphones. It's like, you know, you get a little bit of extra. That's what you're getting from this, right? And so that's where I'm kind of feeling. But then we get a nice email from, you know, Vince and his wife, and this, I get it. I agree, and I understand there's something special to it. I'm just trying to be, you know, there's an art of saying no to certain things, and so I'm trying to figure out if I say yes to this nightly rosary or moving it to the weekend or whatever, I have to say no to something else, because I have been saying no. I've been saying no to the website. I've been saying no to a lot of other projects that I want to do. And so again, it goes back to, is this part of what we do? And if so, then this is part two of the whole conversation. If the ongoing rosary is a part of what we do, how do we make it even more efficacious? How do we make the sound-canceling headphones have even more value to someone so that even more people are showing up and participating? How do we make it so that it's really beneficial to the people that are there? And how do we grow that part of the community? And that's where I'm challenged. Because listen, I mean, one thing I just don't like doing, I don't like creating tons of marketing collateral and images, and I'm spending an inordinate amount of time so that I'm not just posting the same image. And I feel like I am. I'm just posting the same image on Twitter over and over and over again, and on Rosie Army's Facebook page over and over and over again. And that to me just doesn't, that's not good marketing. That doesn't make people want to be a part of something like that. I want to focus on the production of the actual live stream rosary, but I can't escape all the other stuff to remind people that it's happening. And so how do we make that better? How do we build that up? Who can we turn to help us do a better job with that? Because we're so limited in our resources and in the help that we have. So those are the kinds of struggles I have. It's like, if we are supposed to keep doing this, I feel like I need more help to make it successful.
And that's a very valid concern. And I totally understand how that is exhausting, quite honestly. It's all the minutiae that leads up to the simplicity of just praying a rosary.
Yeah, the live stream part, that's easy. It is all the other stuff that it makes it more difficult for us to do.
And you have reached out and asked, and so far have gotten crickets in response.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah.
And that's part of the problem. If anything, it's the lack of help in the social media marketing side that could cause or really threaten this to end. And I would say that perhaps before it comes down to a new minimal amount of live rosary praying, that perhaps we record 4 videos that are not live at all, simply well-produced. This is the Luminous Mysteries of the Rosary. Come pray with us. You can leave prayer intentions in the comments. And then anybody who prays that rosary at any point can just add prayer intentions to it, because they're still praying a rosary with us. Even though it isn't truly live with Greg and Jennifer, it is still live to the person who is in fact praying along with a guide. The prayer is live in the most important way that it matters most, when it ascends up toward heaven. And so having those 4 rosaries, the luminous, the sorrowful, the glorious, and the joyful, That could be the final four that just gets prayed over and over and over again in perpetuity going forward. And it just builds in the comments over time as people discover it and they want to attach their comment to it as a prayer intention and just stays there and grows. I don't see anything wrong with that because we would have produced something, left it there. And depending on what day of the week, they just go, oh, well, today's Thursday. Okay, let me look for the luminous one that they've done and pray it. And then it doesn't have to be live. It's the live thing that has the most need and demand of extra work and social media. You know, these couldn't be one and done. It's an idea.
Yeah. Well, that's one of the more intriguing things, because as you were explaining it, my first thought was like, well, no. We already have so many rosaries already online. Why do we have to do that one again? And even last year on our Greg and Jennifer channel, I released, I think it was the Joyful Mysteries, and had, you know, images and had different stuff for people to look at. And that's only had a few hundred views itself. So you never know how many views you could end up getting. And that's not really what the point is, because, you know, again, some of these rosaries, while we might have had 50 people showing up, they may only get 100, 200 views or whatever. But what I do like about what you said, and I'm not quite sure how it worked, a couple things. We could have those on our Rosary Army website then.
Absolutely. Hey, today's Tuesday. Thank you for choosing this video to pray. The only thing we can identify is the day of the week, because that's what's driving them to watch that particular video, is what day of the week is it? Okay, Wednesday Glories. I'm going to watch that one.
And then the other thing is that I don't think the people can leave comments on a YouTube video when the video is embedded on someone's webpage. They have to click through and go to YouTube to be able to leave the comments there.
Okay.
And so if we had it on Rosary Army's webpage, and if we said, leave your prayers in the comments, we would basically be encouraging people to leave the Rosary Army website and go elsewhere. Unless I could figure out a way, and this is interesting, of having the video on our webpage and having just its comments on our webpage, having like a blog post and having the com box directly on our webpage, and people could leave the comments there instead of on the YouTube video.
Yeah, now and that's going to keep people coming back. They'll want to go. And then, you know, people have time, and it's 3 a.m. They don't know what to do. They're reading the comments, and they're going to be praying for the people who have left comments.
Yeah, I kind of like that idea. I think that's a good idea, because then that's the kind of community that I want to be building. I want people to be praying for and with each other without having to necessarily need us to be, you know, paying our kids to help us set up the equipment every night in different locations in our house and whatever. And then the energy that it takes away from us to be able to do that. I also, quite honestly, I miss our family rosaries. I miss, you know, being in the living room with the kids and us praying the rosary as a family. It's funny, we've been praying the rosary more, but our kids have been praying it less while we've been doing this. And so it's like, you know, and again, I don't want them to have to pay the cost for that. But this is, see, thank you for allowing us to talk through this, because oftentimes it's until we do a podcast, we don't get the chance to actually talk through these ideas. And so that one, I'm actually going to write that down of the dedicated rosaries. Now, what we could do.
But I think in order for that to happen, you need to go ahead and claim a hiatus period so that you can get it done inside the month of June.
Well,
just have it done.
Yes and no. But what we could do is we could still do the live rosaries. When you say you want it like highly produced, I mean, what do you talk about for that? I mean, different than what we're doing right now?
No, it means that it's just going to be an edited video.
How though? How is it edited? What's edited?
Because we're not streaming live, so that means we're just going straight to the SD card and the camera, correct? So it's all going to be one take.
But every time we stream, it saves a recording of it to my computer.
Yes, you're saying taking from existing footage?
We could take an existing rosary that we have right now, or this week or next week, going forward, when we're praying a rosary, we could tell the people that we're praying with. So we're going to do two things tonight. You know, we're definitely offering all this up, but when we go to pray, we're going to be taking tonight's rosary, and we're going to cut just the rosary part out. And so we may pray, or we may say an introduction or something else at the beginning and end of tonight's rosary. Sure. So it's basically, we don't have to take a hiatus. We just tell the people that are praying with us our plans for that night's rosary.
Absolutely.
And so then, because if there's no other editing that has to be done, then we can do that.
And then all we have to do is remember not to talk to particular people watching, because then obviously that doesn't apply for an evergreen version of the rosary.
Right. But that part we never do except for at the beginning and at the end anyway.
Right.
The core of the rosary itself, we just pray the rosary.
No, excellent. We can start.
No, not tonight. I got to give it some thought. I need to get it. I need to visualize it in my head over probably the next week or so, and try to visualize what would that look like on the webpage itself. And I need to think of a few things. But I think this is definitely something of great interest. So thank you.
You're welcome, Greg. Another great email we got was from listener Jacob. He writes, I went back to Mass for the first time this past Saturday. My wife is pregnant, having a boy, our second kid in October, and tends to be a bit more risk-averse than I do. So she's staying home with kiddo number one and watching the stream while I go physically. I procured a Pix and got permission to bring Jesus home to her, which is such a blessing. I walked up, unsure of how I was going to remove my mask, whether I'd present the Pix to be filled first or receive Jesus myself first, unsure if I'm even supposed to leave immediately to bring Jesus home. This was something our priest had brought up in the past with folks bringing Jesus to the homebound, but also wanting to stick around for the final blessing. I got to the head of the line, I removed my mask, and Father whispered, "Pix, Pix," a bit frantically, and I reached into my pocket to withdraw the Pix, but pulled out my car keys. Oh, dear. Felt like I fumbled around for about 18 minutes before I got situated and on my way. It's amazing how awkward things get you when you have no muscle memory for them. Father is also trying to put Jesus into our hands without touching our hands, which has led to Jesus, oh no, being dropped on the floor a few times per Mass. It's ugly, but I think we're all doing our best with what we've got. Thank you for sharing your experiences with this. It's really helped remind me to be patient with my wife and listen to the more prudent voice, even though I'm ready to throw all of the restriction out the window and just get on with my life. We've been through anxiety and depression, heartache, and glimpses of joy as we've navigated this mess. It will be really pleasant when this is just a distant memory.
Yeah, it's interesting. So this past weekend was the fourth weekend where I manned the cameras and did all the live stream for our parish. And when I'm doing this, it's hard for me to concentrate with the Mass in general. I'm focused on making sure that everything is still going out, that it is live streaming, that a camera hasn't frozen up, because that's been a problem that I run into a lot where I'll switch camera views and all of a sudden I'll realize that the lector isn't moving on the camera, and then I'm switching back to the original one, and then it's pointing at a person who isn't reading at the time, and you know, just trying to keep things like that. And so to stay worshipful in the midst of this is difficult. Well, this past weekend was the first weekend where I did two Mass live streams in one weekend. I did the Saturday evening vigil, and then I did Sunday morning. And on Saturday evening vigil, even though I had prepared slides that would be shown up on the screen that have all of the Mass readings on them, I couldn't tell you a single one of the Mass readings this past weekend. I did, and part of it is because of the distraction, right? It's like I'm sitting there making sure the slides are working, and on Saturday night, you know, the image of the lector wasn't on the screen at the same time as the words, and it was goofy. But I do remember our priest's homily. That did get through. I heard that because when he gives the homily, I'm just dealing with one camera. I keep it on him, and it worked pretty well. But then it was on Sunday morning, and this was the first weekend where there were more people, not a lot, but like up to 25 people or whatever, because, again, we have a small worship space, but the first 25 people could be there in the sanctuary during Mass. And It was still odd because the chairs, these, you know, the classroom, uncomfortable plastic classroom chairs placed 6 feet apart from each other, but I was still able to get more out of the Mass on Sunday morning. I don't know if it was because I went to Mass again the night before. I don't know if it was just because things were working better technically, but for whatever reason, I was able to get more out of it. And it was the fourth week back. And I think that even though there's still weirdness, I wasn't thinking so much about the masks this fourth week as I was the first week. And I wasn't thinking so much about the fact that the chairs were 6 feet apart from each other this week as I was the first week. And so I think that we're all going to have to deal with weirdness going back in. But we're still struggling with some things. We personally are still wrestling with, and you and I had a long conversation yesterday, just about going back to receiving the Eucharist in the hand versus the tongue, and our discomfort with receiving Jesus in the hand. Because we'd gotten to a point where we had come to the realization that we just were not comfortable receiving the Eucharist on the hand anymore, but now we're being told that we can't receive the Eucharist unless we receive in the hand. And so we're questioning whether or not it would be more efficacious for us personally, not for, we're not making some sort of broad generalization for everyone that you're a bad Catholic if you're receiving in the hand or whatever. We're not saying that. But we have personally been brought to the devotion of receiving on the tongue and whether or not we should refrain from receiving the Eucharist again until we can receive on the tongue. And it's really kind of a difficult thing for me to explain why this is important. And I kind of don't even really have much of a desire to defend it. Like, I don't have much of a desire to go and let me show you where the church said this, right, and let me show you where for all these hundreds of years no one ever received Jesus in the hand, and let me show, I just want to receive Jesus on the tongue because I feel that's the most reverent way that I possibly can do it. And that's how I feel the most comfortable, and that's how I feel it's supposed to be done, period. I was going to say for me, but that's the way I think it should be done, period. I would have no issue whatsoever if there was a mandate from the Pope down that going forward, the faithful could not receive the Eucharist unless you were receiving the Eucharist on the tongue only. I would have no issue with that. I would have no issue with Mass being 10 minutes longer so that only the priest or deacon could distribute.
Shorter, not longer.
What did I say?
You said that the homily was 10 minutes longer so that the priest could.
Did I say homily or did I say Mass?
I thought you said homily, but yeah, the point being,
the priest should
be the one feeding the flock.
I would be fine if Mass was longer. I don't care how long the homily. The priest could keep the homilies as long as he wants.
Exactly.
Mass could be 10 minutes longer so that I can show extra reverence. These are things that, again, from the first week to the fourth week, of the first week of going back to the fourth week now, but having gone back to receiving the Eucharist on the hand again, I think that I would personally, I say this, I'm hesitant to say it because I feel like I'm committing to something, and I may revert back to on the hand again. But I feel
you can talk about the struggle in your thought. What are you thinking?
I should just do a spiritual communion, and be okay with it. Be okay with it right now.
Right.
And here's the thing that I will say though. I'm struggling with, I haven't unfriended a lot of people, but I have stopped following a lot of people that I consider friends on social media. I mean, genuinely people that I consider friends, I have stopped following them because I feel as though this question of receiving on the hand or in the tongue or on the tongue is creating more division. I feel as though there's these two factions of the church that have become more fractured than ever before, in my lifetime at least. And there's so much, we all want to just go back to Jesus, but we all want to go back to Jesus the way that we want to go back to Jesus. And the way you want to go back to Jesus isn't the way I want to go back to Jesus. And so therefore, someone's wrong. And that is hurting me more than the way that I received the Eucharist. I think Jesus would be completely fine with us having spiritual communion if there's no more division and anger and vitriol in the church. I feel like there's more vitriol in the church now than there ever has been. And it's so weird because, like, is it because of the coronavirus? Or was it already there and it was getting worse? And this just was like a final a final, you know, blowing up of everything.
Here's a thought I had this morning while I was getting caught up on watching some extra homilies from other priests that I subscribe to on YouTube that I trust their faithfulness to the teachings of Christ. And I feel like they are very interested in sharing the truth and the joy of Christ. And so I was watching this one YouTube video on the body, Corpus Christi. Okay, this is just the most recent homily that we all got to hear. And something sort of jumped out at me while I was watching that video. It made me think about the vision that Pope Leo XIII had, where he had a vision while he was celebrating Mass all those hundreds of years ago of a conversation between God and Satan. Okay, now this is not all documented fact. If you do the research on this very famous vision of Pope Leo XIII witnessing this conversation between God and Satan, you will also see that the word legend is very closely associated with the retelling of this vision. But tradition has passed on this story for hundreds of years now. We recently talked about it a few podcasts ago when we did that timeline and is this a chastisement from God, where in that vision, Satan was basically making like a kind of a wager deal with God of give me 100 years and I could destroy the church. Because it's not that God was going to give him power to grow. He can't grow any more than he already is in his size and power as the evil one. But if the church can be weakened significantly over 100 years, then it will appear as if Satan grew in power. It's just that who Satan is fighting is so weak, it's easy. The church becomes easier prey. Okay? So I believe that there is a real great truth in that vision. So now you fast forward to today, and you look at what the coronavirus is doing and has done to the church, and the closing of it, how quickly it closed. To me, this is my personal Jennifer Willits reflection here. Because the church has been weakened by the enemy over the last 100 years, it was very easy for it to close in response to the coronavirus. To me, there is a direct parallel that the coronavirus seems huge and frightening and terrifying. Church closed. When really, it's deadly, like influenza is deadly, like many other diseases can be deadly. But because the church is so weak now, it folded very quickly because the coronavirus just seems bigger, like Satan seems bigger, when really it only has a set power to it. It's just that because the church is suffering right now, it couldn't respond the way that it should have. And so I saw those connections when I was praying this morning. So what do you do with that? Okay, well, we got to be busy about trying to be strong again. We need to rebuild. We need to strengthen our devotion. Once again, we need to realize and remember who we are in Christ. We need to remember and go back to as close to the truth as we know it to be, what we have access to it. So we have to keep learning, informing ourselves as much as possible to what was it that Christ started? Okay, what is the deposit of the faith really? What were those core teachings? Is it possible something went off track somewhere in a couple centuries ago? Like, we are smart enough to find this out. We are smart enough to start looking for root causes and then reacting accordingly and realizing we need to be about the business of reclaiming our holiness. We must be very, that needs to be our number one priority, reclaiming our holiness. So, one obvious thing to look at is the way we treat the Eucharist. Obviously, if this is truly the source and summit of our faith, like the Catholic Church has been telling us, then we owe it to Christ to be as reverent as humanly possible. So what does that look like? to be reverent now is no longer being permitted by our shepherds. That's one thing I've noticed. It's like there is a fear of being reverent. A fear. What?
So, well, explain that though. I mean, when you that's a very broad statement.
What I mean by that is when you look at the two methods on the hand, it was a perception of safety. So let's receive the Eucharist on the hand. On the tongue, there's a fear that to be reverent in that way now comes with a possibility of contagious death or something, or whatever the shepherds are saying now, that that's why you cannot receive on the tongue, why it's being denied the faithful, or the priests are being encouraged to avoid that. You can't do it openly. You have to hide. You can't let it be seen. If you're going to have reverence, now has to be hidden. I'm like, what are we saying? What is happening in our church right now that we cannot receive on the tongue openly as a witness of reverence? Reverence must be shared and witnessed so that other people can see it and hopefully desire to want to copy it and also be reverent themselves. It's daring. But what if this? What did the saints die for then if it wasn't for reverence? So this is some of the thoughts that have been going through my mind as I am doing things to try to seek out truth from shepherds that I know have a track record of being very, very faithful to the deposit of the faith, the teachings of Christ. And I think that you will quickly come to the conclusion that if you embark upon similar research, you will see that there are, in fact, more reverent ways of treating our Eucharistic Lord. And then pray about it and see where you are led. I know before the pandemic really shut down everything in our country, I was feeling completely committed to receiving our Lord kneeling and on the tongue. Now, obviously, if your knees are in physical shape, you know, like you can't kneel for whatever reason, that I'm not even sure what the protocol is. If you cannot physically kneel, then maybe there's another way you can receive on the tongue. Maybe just remain in your seat or something. But once you learn that there is a better way of doing something, a more reverent way of doing something, why would you not consider it? I guess it's the obvious question I might have. If you learn that there is a better way, why not try it? Obviously, I personally did not know about that until very recently. The conviction to receive our Lord on the tongue did not hit till 2020 for me, and I'm almost 50 years old. That means...
I think you started last year.
I thought it was January of this year.
On the tongue or kneeling on the tongue?
I don't know. Very close. Kneeling on the tongue was definitely January 2020. Yeah. So, but that just illustrates to you the amount of decades I went receiving our Lord on the hand because I'm simply doing what the church taught me. I was trusting the church on that guidance because the church made it allowable. The church made it allowable. So I knew I was innocent, but I still wondered, well, it wasn't always this way? You mean the receiving the Eucharist on the hand is somewhat recent, like in the last 50 years? That's interesting. So the church existed for hundreds and hundreds of years doing another way, receiving only on the tongue. And I thought, well, isn't that interesting? Why did it stop? You know, I started asking questions because ultimately I'm being fueled by my desire to be as holy as I can be. So I knew there has to be a better way. What can I learn today? And so, dear listener, I will tell you, it is a worthy thing to research these things. Ask these very questions. How can you make your holy day, the holiness of your life more holy? How are you spending the Sabbath? That's a recent conviction I've had during this pandemic. What am I really doing on the Lord's Day? How am I really spending my Sunday that's uniquely different than Monday through Saturday? Or is it just like one day leads to another, and I can't tell one day apart from the next because the pandemic has forced me to stay indoors and everything's running together, and now it's not special. I can't allow that. I can't allow that. I have to make an effort because when I die, guess who I have to face? Guess who is going to be asking me how I spent my time, what I did, what words I used, you know, I have to face God. I have to face God. I have to be ready to give an answer for all that I've done. And, you know, this is just the kind of thing that we've been dealing with in our house. And so going forward, if my pastor, who I know listens to the show, if for whatever reason he is unable to distribute our Lord in the Eucharist to me from his hand to my mouth while I'm kneeling, I will happily make a spiritual communion until the day he feels that he can. Because I don't know what else to do. I cannot control what anybody else does, but I certainly can control what I do.
What about the children?
Well, I've already sat down and I've talked with the children, and I explained this to them as well. And I told them that if the priest cannot feed you this way, and it's absolutely okay, and in fact, probably better for your soul if you simply make a spiritual communion until the day your priest can feed you this way. So that, and it's not a ding on humans, people, clergy. It's really more about being the most reverent you can be for the holiest of holies, the most high God himself. We owe it to God to do this. And sometimes, you know, humanity is broken. We can't help this. And if a priest isn't able or willing or whatever to feed the sheep a certain way, then okay, he has to figure that out. That's not my job. You know, it isn't my place to tell any priest what he does, but I'm responsible for the children. We, Greg and Jennifer, have to guide our children how to handle these very delicate, complicated situations. So I had no problem yesterday gathering all the kids and having this conversation, say, we owe it to God. He is worth the wait. He is worth the wait. So let's do that. Let's make a really good spiritual communion. Now, in the meantime, I don't see anything wrong with approaching your local pastor privately. Okay, don't put them on a spot in front of everybody, but just privately pull them aside and ask your priest, can you do this for me? Is there any way you would consider any day of the week? Can I come maybe on a Wednesday? I'll meet you here and you can, you know, offer me communion while I'm kneeling on the tongue. And then you base your next decision on whatever he says. Obviously, you want to respect your priest. I think you should absolutely respect your priest. Talk to your priest. See what arrangements can be made. And then you very lovingly, politely make a decision based on the answer you get. That's my advice. What do you think of that?
I think it's all good. I was going to say well and good, but then that sounds dismissive. I think that's all good. I think that, you know, I said at the beginning of this that I don't really have a desire to defend this. Along those lines, though, and you said a few things, it's like the reason why we do this show, we've done the media for as long as we have, is because we do have a great desire for people to know more about their faith, to have a desire to grow in your faith, to challenge yourself. And the challenge that I do have right now is, again, part of it's being bred from the being perplexed as I am about division in the church right now, that I very much want to have a more solid understanding of historically and in recent times, what truly should we as a people be doing for the celebration of the Mass. And what I think part of my struggle is, how do we, Greg and Jennifer, through, you know, what platform we have, how do we help facilitate that? Because one thing that we have gotten from talking not only with our priests, but other priests as well, throughout this entire coronavirus discussion and outside of it, is this growing sense of a loss of respect of the Mass. How do we help fix that? How do we help bring back a greater sense of reverence and awe that should be there? Because it's easy. For me, in my faith life, it's easy for me to know what I need to do, but what I do to grow in reverence and awe isn't necessarily something that's going to help someone else.
Well, first of all, Greg, I think the first thing we should do is simply acknowledge that we have been slowly weakened over a long period of time. It's like we are walking around with Catholic vitamin deficiencies of a magnified scale. And our weakened state is something that has to be corrected. We need to be putting in really good formation so that we can strengthen, so that we can have the courage of a saint. Right now, we don't have the courage like our predecessor saints have had. We don't have the courage of St. Charles Borromeo. We don't have the courage of St. Jose, who, I apologize, I can't recall his
name. Maria Escriva?
No, I mean, yes, that one too, but St. Jose is the one from the Mexican government persecution in the 1920s, a 14-year-old boy who was marched, they removed the soles of his feet because he would not renounce his Catholic faith, and then they made a march on his disfigured feet to the point of his, to the place of his execution at the age of 14, he was saying, Vivo Cristo Rey. Where does that courage come from? It comes from being fully fortified in your Catholicism. That is what a great many of us are missing today. We are just deficient. If you think of deficient in vitamins, deficient in those things, we're just weakened and we're walking around a little bit like Catholic zombies. We think we're all there. We think we're formed. We're not. Surprise, you're weak. This is the problem. We can't fight. We're a little bit of a ragtag army right now. We have to realize, oh my goodness, I need to be eating my vegetables. I need to do whatever I have to do to strengthen myself once again. I need to be rereading perhaps, or maybe for the first time, good classic literature, where the faith was more beautifully represented.
Now, I will say to that, and you actually just reminded me of something I have been doing over the last couple of weeks. Someone that's listening, they probably are already taking their faith pretty seriously if they're listening to this show. I can't imagine someone who isn't, you know, taking their faith seriously listening to a show like this. If that's you, I'd kind of like to talk to you. That's a curiosity to me. But even someone who's taking their faith seriously might start feeling dryness and not sure how they need to be moving to grow in their faith, to grow in greater holiness, as we've been saying. It's easy to say, you need to be growing in holiness. You need to be growing in sainthood. You need to be growing in reading things. And it's easy to say that. But oftentimes, and again, through all this division of these last few weeks, and even the question of do we keep doing the rosary every night, and all these questions, right? My prayer has been, Holy Spirit, please stir up whatever in me is supposed to be stirred up. Because if whatever is supposed to be stirred up is stirred up, I will go in the right direction. And the reason I know that is because I think about the early days of Rosary Army. And when I first started making rosaries, and when the idea of rosaryarmy.com came out, there was nothing you could have done to stop me from doing those things. The Holy Spirit stirred up in me something so greatly that it was nearly impossible for me not to act. That's what we need to be praying for in each of us, because then we each are bringing our own special gifts, talents, charisms that were given to you by God to the table for our own sanctity, for the sanctity of others, and for the holiness of the church. But if in the midst of coronavirus and in the midst of division in the church and in the midst of, quite honestly, several decades of questionable leadership in some cases in the church, that our faith may have accidentally gone to room temperature, we may need the help of the Holy Spirit to get the heat going again and to ask the Holy Spirit to fan the flames within us to be able to truly act in the way that we are being called from our baptisms to act. in a way that we can't necessarily do without the help of the Holy Spirit. And so even for me in the last few weeks, not necessarily, you know, being overly confused, but just definitely being in a place of some level of discernment, but I'm not exactly sure what I'm discerning, but definitely praying, stir up within me that which needs to be stirred up so that I can be doing with clarity and certainty that which God wants me to do. Because otherwise, I'm just asking, what is it that you want, God? What is it that you want? What is it that you want? But if I ask the Holy Spirit, stir up within me that which you want me to be using, then that passion comes out, that inescapable desire to do what you're supposed to do and what you're called to do.
One of the videos I watched was a YouTube video of a homily from Father Mark Goring. He's got a lot of followers, but he's a Canadian priest, a young guy. And I was introduced to him, a good friend of mine from Fort Wayne, Indiana. She shared his Pentecost, Feast of the Pentecost homily with me. I'd never heard of this priest before she sent me that video. But in that video, I was blown away by the zeal of which Father Mark Goring preached his homily. And he actually said the words, Greg, we need a new Pentecost.
Oh, yeah. I believe it. We do. We honestly, truly do. Yeah. And we also need our shepherds to be leading us to that new Pentecost.
That'd be great.
That we need our fellow Christians to help us to be led to that Pentecost. And I don't want to say something as trite as we need to hold ourselves accountable to this, but who listening right now is doing everything that you're called to do? Who listening right now is a saint? Who listening right now has achieved the ultimate holiness? I certainly haven't. Now, who wants it? Who wants more for God? Who wants more for our fellow Christians? Who wants more holiness so that you can achieve a greater level of glory in heaven with God, the glory that he has established for you, or that he is waiting for you, I should say. So what are we doing? And what can we be doing? And again, it's just Holy Spirit. Stir up within me whatever it is that you need stirred up so that I can do what I need to be doing, because I don't know. I know I'm human. I don't have the clarity. Stir up within me. Stir up within me the desire that you want me to have. I give you permission, Holy Spirit. Do this. Please come, Holy Spirit. Stir it up within me.
We know that the Holy Spirit is a moving force. And we know that the Holy Spirit can lead us to places. So why not ask the Holy Spirit to continuously lead us to the truth, to lead us to those good and courageous shepherds so that we can grow in holiness?
And one of the ways that we've always desire to help others grow in holiness, to grow in their Catholic faith, is by the creation of Catholic media. We have seen this happen time and again, people coming into the church. We've seen marriages and vocations and so many other things come just from encouraging people to be thinking more regularly and more deliberately about the way that God is working in their lives. And so whenever I have the opportunity to speak with and to work with and to be around other people who take Catholic media seriously, it's just very edifying to me. And found out about this Catholic conference for kids. And we're going to put a link to this over on our website. If you go to gregandjennifer.com/331, it's an online Catholic conference. You can sign up for it for free for your kids. It's happening this weekend in June. June 20th and 21st, I think, are the dates on this. And we'll get confirmation on that in our conversations coming up with our friend Jason Taylor. Now, Jason Taylor was, and I say this to him when we're talking, he stood out among the crowd years ago when I had moved to Denver and I was working for the Archdiocese, and I had been challenged with building up an apostolate for the Archdiocese, New Evangelization Media. And the things that we were able to do, one thing that we didn't talk about in our conversation that you're about to hear, Jason and I created several pieces of media together that we learned a lot from, we're super proud of. If we were to do it again today, we probably would do it a little bit differently. One of which was a Stations of the Cross audio that he and I put together. I narrated, he did all of the audio engineering and got a lot of voices and extras and sounds and all sorts of amazing things. That was so well received that EWTN airs it on EWTN Radio nearly every Good Friday, and they have for several years now. And it's something that just I have a lot of. I'm proud of the hire of Jason all those years ago. I'm proud of the work that he and I were able to do together. Filmed a video in our house that you may have seen, like five ways of building up family spirituality or something like that, that Jennifer's in it and all the kids, and we filmed it in our house in Colorado. And just, it was a great opportunity. Well, Jason has taken the lead on this new conference that's happening this weekend for kids. And just wanted to share with you a conversation that we had this morning with Jason Taylor. You know, it's kind of funny. Lately, we've talked so much about our past 7-8 years or so, and one of the things that we talked about was moving to Denver and some of the things that happened when we were in Denver. And we don't necessarily talk about some of the good things that have happened when we moved to Denver. And one of the good things that happened when we moved to Denver was I actually had the opportunity to work with someone who, one of the things I'd hoped to do was to start up a studio for the Archdiocese there and to really create media for evangelization. I mean, that was one of the things why they hired me in the first place, so that we could really evangelize using new media. And when I got there and I started to try to find someone who could help me with this vision, it was one of the hardest things for me to do. And I interviewed, I don't know how many people. I am not exaggerating. I had a stack of resumes, probably about 9 or 10 inches tall. That's how many resumes I had. And I just was so frustrated. I didn't think I could ever find someone. And then this guy, Jason from Canada, all of a sudden shows up out of nowhere and applies. And Jason, I put you through the rigmarole and made you come to Denver and then back. Did I make you come back? Did you fly in and out in a day like I did when I interviewed?
I did, actually. It was very surreal. I left that morning and got home at night, laid down my head on my bed and looked at my wife and said, wow, I just went to Denver and back, you know?
From Canada, no less. I mean, so it was even harder exactly. For you because you had to go through, customs or whatever, or through immigration and all that too. So when you, that was what year?
15, it could have been.
No, 2014. Suddenly my dates,
14, okay. Yeah,
which I'm normally good at, because that would have been about a year after I had gotten there. So, here you were doing a lot of different types of media, and that's really what I wanted. I wanted someone who could wear multiple caps, who had done graphic design, could do video, could do audio. And when you found out about the job in Denver, it was, I believe it was your wife that just said, wow, you should apply for this, wasn't it?
Yeah, definitely. The job description just felt like it was speaking to me directly. And I was a fanboy of Greg Willett. I had been following your your career. So the idea of, hey, this guy's a Catholic media pioneer, to get to work with him could be amazing. So there's, on multiple levels, the job was really exciting.
So, okay, so this is where my brain gets fuzzy, and I tend to forget things. I mean, you knew who I was before I called you?
I did, yeah. I know Rosaries. I mean, I know I'd watched your sitcom. I'd seen your
that Catholic show.
So when you sent me your demo stuff, and again, it was the first time I saw somebody who, and I remember talking to people over at the Augustine Institute, and they had seen the job description. They're like, you're never going to find someone who could do all those kinds of things. I'm like, well, I can do all those things, so I know that there's someone else out there. And then when you showed up, one of the things, so you had strengths in certain areas, but not in others. And you, when you showed up in Denver, and it's like, okay, you helped me create the list of all the equipment that we needed. We bought all that stuff. You designed the studio that we ended up having. I mean, I knew was the area that we had. It's like, okay, what do you want to do? And then you created this 3D rendering of it that actually was an animation to walk us through. And you and I actually had that opportunity to start up this studio. And you know, there was a, it was a very exciting, the idea of the things that we could do. And I feel like there were a lot of things that ended up not coming to fruition, but a lot of, I feel like it was a place where you and I learned a lot of lessons.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. It was a great experience.
What were the biggest challenge lessons that you walked away from? Like, you know, when you eventually left the Archdiocese of Denver and went back to Canada, what were some of the lessons you're like, okay, as I'm going forward and I'm going to start creating my own media, Jason Taylor media empire in Canada, what were the lessons, like what were the things that you felt still needed to be done in terms of Catholic new media that maybe you hadn't had that opportunity to do?
Well, I mean, I've always had a heart for Catholic media for kids, so definitely that was something I walked away. In fact, that was the next thing I did after Denver. But it's funny, like I work from home now. I have to say, the studio environment, it's kind of like, this is kind of a random thought really quickly, but working there with you guys in the studio, it has a lot of pluses, like being together, being able to connect one-on-one. But now I'm working from home. I see a lot of pluses to working from home now. So I don't even know where I'm going with that. But
well, I agree.
Your question.
I agree completely with that.
Yeah, because, you know, it's fun. Yeah, So to your question, though, the one thing I definitely walked away from there was I got exposed to, like, to meet you. I got to meet a lot of leaders in Catholic media. And, I mean, I got to go to the Augustine Institute. There's some major, major leaders within the Archdiocese itself. And I kind of walked away from there thinking, wow, like, kind of naively, but I thought if these guys can do it, I can do it. The difference is they have a team of like 50 people. But so I had kind of a, I definitely had an inspiration to think that, like, because, you know, Denver is the hub of Catholic media. So being exposed to that really was a positive experience for me, just to give me kind of some confidence in that respect as well.
So what do you find yourself keeping you busy these days? Because I know you're not just only working on things for children. So how are you passing your time now that the Denver chapter of your life has closed?
Sure. So Denver chapter closed, it could have been 3 years ago. It could have been more than that. I'm not even, I have to sit down and do the math. Right after Denver, I launched a Kickstarter, and you guys were kind enough to kind of put a shout out there to people about that. And I launched a successful Kickstarter where I launched a Catholic media show for kids. I produced 4 episodes over 2 years. That was aired on EWTN, on Formed, on Shalom World TV. So that's really been around the world.
And that's Opus Joyous?
That's the Opus Joyous show, yep. And so then after that, I lived as a starving artist, like pretty much a starving artist for a couple of years. That was a Kickstarter that was supposed to last a year. That took 2 years. So that was pretty neat experience. In the midst of that, I've had many children. I have 7 children, and we have this a unique ability, a blessing to have multiples. So my wife has, well, I do too, but 3 sets of twins. So we have 2 sets of fraternal twins, and now we have a set of identical twins, and we have a singleton. And our single child was born in the United States. He is an American dual citizen, so he's American citizen and Canadian citizen. He was born on Canada Day in the United States, and his godfather is a friend of, yeah, and his godfather is a friend of mine from Mexico. He lives in the States, but he is the his middle name is NAFTA. I was kidding.
so with all these kids and you're working from home, how do you do that? Because I mean, that's one of the struggles that now that I'm back working from home again and kids have been home so much, how do you balance that?
Okay, well, I mean, I do have a day job as well, so I don't do Catholic media for kids full time. I am the director of video and podcasting for LifeSite News. I've been doing that for a year. And that has been a really powerful experience, just kind of being on the front lines there and kind of, you know, in a culture war on many levels. And then on the side, I think we're talking about today would be this, I don't know if we actually haven't mentioned it yet, but on the side, I'm producing a conference, running a conference for Catholic kids. So it's coming up next weekend. So that is something that's been taking a lot of my spare time, in addition to fathering and having a full-time job.
So this Catholic conference, and we'll put a link to this, of course, on our website, because this is coming up very soon. It's going to be happening this weekend, actually, Saturday, June 20th and Sunday, June 21st. But this is Ocean of Mercy. It's a virtual Catholic conference for kids. It's, and so now you have this other thing. It's Essential Catholic Presents. Is Essential Catholic you, or is that you with another organization? Who is EssentialCatholic.com?
Sure. So I'm actually still trying to figure that out, but that's an inspiration I had right around the same time I decided, had this crazy thought of producing this Catholic conference for kids. So Essential Catholic is really just, it's a response to this pandemic we're in. People saying, what is essential? What is essential? You know? And really just, it's kind of like my Catholic faith is essential. So I just like, I thought, hey, that's a neat name for a company, Essential Catholic. So I literally went online and I looked to see if anybody else had the domain. Nope. Looked to see if anybody else had like the various social media channels. Nope. Okay. Well, registered the domain. Now I have various, you know, the various social media handles now. And so under that umbrella, Essential Catholic, I'm running this conference. And if you go to check out the conference website, you'll see the logo. It's kind of two rays. It really represents the divine mercy, the rays coming out of Jesus' heart there. And that logo is based on divine mercy. And this conference actually is really evolves around divine mercy as well. And just felt like strongly that the world needs a bit of mercy here. So gathering children together to really, the heart of it is really, we're going to end each day with the Divine Mercy Chaplet. So we're gathering children together here to pray the Divine Mercy Chaplet. We're going to have entertainment and kind of fun stuff that leads into the prayer. But at the end of each day, it just to me, it's like a really powerful thought to think I could gather children, kids from all over the world and genuinely pray to God to have mercy on us and on the whole world. That really moved my heart when this whole thought of this project came to be. Because, I mean, I've seen it in my own life. My kids have prayed for people and we've seen fruit and graces from that. So it's kind of a gratifying thought to think, you know, in my life, I could gather kids together during these crazy times to really pray to God for mercy. So,
can you tell us a little bit more about the schedule for the event? Speakers lined up and...
For sure. Yeah. Thank you. So that was, had to keep that in mind. Like a lot of these conferences go 4 or 5 hours. So these are kids. So we're going to run an hour and a half, might just be a little bit short of an hour and a half each day, from 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time till 3:30. So we will end with the Divine Mercy Chaplet at 3. And the schedule really includes an array of really some of the top Catholic media producers for kids. So we have Brother Francis. He's playing a key role in this. In fact, I've been working with the guys at Herald Entertainment who produced Brother Francis. And they've been amazing. They actually have created original content. So Brother Francis is going to be, Brother Francis is going to be Skyping Opus. Opus is one of the characters for my show. And Opus is going to MC this conference. So Brother Francis is going to be Skyping with him. It's really fun.
Oh.
it's really, it's pretty neat. So Brother Francis, Lucas Storyteller, that's done by CCC of America. They are really, CCC of America and Brother Francis are really genuinely like the leaders in kind of the space for Catholic media for kids. They have a new animated series called Lucas Storyteller. EWTN is going to be part of this. They have Tompkin, his name is, a cute little character. And then there's also a piece from EWTN based on the Divine Mercy Chaplet. There's also somebody I know personally, Carissa Douglas, she has a ministry called The Little Duglings. She has 13 kids, and she had a show on a network called Shalom World TV, and she is going to be doing a really cute reading of one of her books based on reconciliation, which is the heart of divine mercy, and her kids are part of the reading, so that's really nice. And then I have a brother-in-law, Father Adam Zettel, and one of his fellow priests. They are just like this fun, dynamic, high-energy duo, and they're going to be basically like the chaplains of this. So Opus, the main character, will bounce back and forth to those guys, and they are going to be starting it off with an opening prayer, singing a song, and then this is called the Ocean of Mercy Conference. So I said to my brother-in-law, Father Adam, I said, like, is there any way you could get close to an ocean? He's like, no. Not really. And he's like, wait a sec. he's in Texas, but not close to the Gulf of Mexico or anything. But he says, wait a second. Next week, we're actually flying to California. So so he literally has shot a scene at the ocean.
Oh, that's cool.
It is cool. Yeah, we're talking about the Ocean of Mercy. I don't want to forget anybody else, but there's a Canadian duo, husband and wife. They're called A Guy and a Girl. They do a lot of the youth ministry conferences in Canada. And they are, they've written this original song called Jesus, We Trust in You. It's really moving. Like the first time I heard it, I genuinely had a tear in my eye. It's just a really nice song. So yeah, I mean, there's a good long list of Catholic, supposed to be Catholic creatives for kids that are part of this.
And a really big one that you haven't even mentioned yet. And this is the one that when Jennifer heard about it, because she's become a major fangirl of one of the people who's going to be appearing. And he's all over the place lately. It's a big get for you. You are having Jonathan Rumi, the actor who played Jesus in The Chosen, is going to be a part of this as well. How did that come about?
Well, basically, I don't know if you guys are aware, he praised the Divine Mercy Chaplet as well. I don't know if you guys knew that.
Yes.
If you didn't know that.
I am aware.
You didn't know that, yeah. So he's a devout Catholic. A lot of people didn't realize that. So reached out to him and connected with one of the kind of the staff that helps coordinate some of these things. And he said he's willing to be part of this. So today I'm actually speaking with him through Skype, and I've got 12 of these little clips from kids around the world, and they're going to be asking him questions. It's really cute. I mean, some of the questions are just kind of silly. Some of them are, some of them are really well thought out. Like one of them, I'll just tell you, one of them is really fun. This little tiny girl, this little girl from California, she says, if Jesus could walk on water, could he walk on apple juice?
And you got to have some of those questions, because that's how children think. And that's part of the beauty of children. And I do like the obvious tie in here of letting the little, like, let the children come to me is very well represented in your conference by having children literally come towards a well-known actor who played the role of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And so that's very exciting. So I do have a question about...
Well, hold on. There's another person, who a little girl who it was also very excited that she had an opportunity to ask a question. And I got to tell you, our daughter, Lily Willits, was super excited. When you sent me a message and say, hey, would Lily be willing to ask a question of Jonathan Rumi? And I literally went to her and I said, so he's doing this conference and Jonathan Rumi, and the fact that our daughter knew who Jonathan Rumi was,
by it's
like
name.
I didn't have to say the guy who played Jesus in The Chosen. I said, Jonathan Rumi. She's like, she got all fangirlish then. So she was very excited to be able to ask him a question. And so thank you for that opportunity for our daughter as well.
I was curious.
Well, she was one of the ones that really articulated the question well. So thank you to her as well. Let her know that. So.
Well, we'll definitely pass that that on to her as well. And again, we were just so tickled to put that together this morning and to fire off that video clip over to you. But it did make me curious, what is the age of child, the age range of children that you think is the ideal audience for this conference?
I would say 5 to 12 is the ideal audience. But I mean, a lot of younger kids will enjoy this. And then maybe some older kids would enjoy this. But I think 5 to 12 is generally a safe range for parents that are kind of curious about the content here. So, I mean, I've seen it with kids media though. I know some parents, some shows you put on for your kids and parents kind of watch over their shoulder. So, there's a lot of like genuinely a lot of fun, interesting things here. So my hope is that it's not just the kids that watch it. Like hopefully the parents will consider watching it with their kids. But the range again is 5 to 12 would be the general range. Yeah.
It's a lot of people haven't done these online conferences. I mean, there's been a zillion of them during the coronavirus, but how does it work? Mm-hmm. How does it work? I mean, what's the whole process? It's a conference. So what's the cost?
Is registration required?
How do they watch it? All those kinds of things. What should people expect if they want to participate in this? You know, make it as simple as possible for them to be able to do that.
Sure. Of course. Basically go to the website, register. It's a free registration. You'll get a link, and then access, you'll have an access code in the link. Click that the day of. And the whole event will be, it'll say live, but it'll play as a live stream. So it won't be like you have to watch each individual clip and keep clicking links. It'll play as an hour and a half live stream. It won't be live per se, but it'll have that feel where you can just watch it live. And then if somebody would like to watch it again, I mean, we will offer a post-conference family pass, because there are various expenses related to this, and that'll just help us cover that as well. And I don't think, Greg, you're going to have a link on your website as well, right? That's probably an easy way for people to get there.
So if people want a link to this, and I'll put an actual graphic. If you go to gregandjennifer.com/331, that's the number of this episode, 331. They'll be able to see the graphic right there. Click that. It'll bring you over to the conference so that you can register for that, as well as if you are right now listening on your phone, and if you look down in your podcatcher, you probably see an image for the conference right there is showing as you're listening to this. And depending on your podcatcher that you're using, there might be a link right there as well. If you click that link right now, that'll take you over to the conference registration page too.
And that's a cool feature of your podcast lately, by the way, that you can have those pictures and links and stuff like that. That's been fun. I am a podcast listener. I haven't listened for a few weeks, but I am a listener. So it's neat to, you guys are amazing to just share your life, but I know for me, and I'm sure that's the whole point of other people, is there's some consolation in knowing that I'm not alone and kind of some of the ups and downs and hills and valleys, you know?
Absolutely. Well, you're definitely not alone.
It's weird.
Good company.
For me, Jason, it's weird to, how old are you now?
45. I was going to make an old man voice there, but I'm 45.
So you're just a few years younger than us, but even still, it's like when I watch you, you've always exuded this youthfulness. You have a joy that is contagious for many, and it's something that is admirable. And I see you now with things like this conference and with Opus Joyous and with all the other work that you're constantly doing and the innovativeness that you do. It makes me reminiscent of the early days of when we started getting into these things. And it you inspire me, Jason, because I see how you're taking so many more chances. In the last few years, you know, and we've talked about this on the show, I have gotten more cautious. And that caution is an indicator of lack of trust in God in some cases, a lack of trust of things are going to work out, lack of, you know, or a fear of embarrassing myself or something like that. And I see things like, I mean, you had this idea and you said, I'm going to launch this Catholic conference and I'm going to trust God. And you get all these amazing people that are going to be a part of this Catholic conference for kids. You got one of the more popular actors out there right now that so many people are talking about willing to participate in this. And it starts with your trust in God and your desire to use the medium, the technology, and the skills that are given to you and really run with it. And I admire the heck out of you. Your enthusiasm is appreciated. And it's a reminder to me to not just sit on my laurels and be satisfied with what we've got. So thank you for that.
No problem. You know what? You could probably relate to this. I have a good wife.
Yeah.
Yes, you do.
I told her about this idea. I have this crazy idea. There's a lot of these virtual conferences happening. Like, I live in the middle of nowhere. If you saw, out my window, you'd laugh. Like, my neighbors are Amish. I'll tell you another story another day. Like, my wife delivered one of the babies in our home. Put it that way.
So, wow.
We live in the middle of nowhere. And the thought of me, kind of this little guy out in the middle of nowhere, somehow coordinating this conference, it seemed kind of delusional. But then I read it by my wife, and she's like, no, that's an amazing idea. Go for it. So I just kept reaching out, and everybody kept saying yes. And then it was so my point about having a good wife, like, my wife has supported this along the way. In fact, it's been a sacrifice for her because I've worked many late nights in this, right? So I have said my yes part, but my wife really just, I've also said a lot of no's. My wife kept saying, no, you said yes. Keep doing this. So.
Yes, your wife. Yeah. I've had the pleasure of meeting her before you had all the extra children that you have now.
we thought we had a lot back then.
Yes, and she is a real gem of a woman because she is so pro-life and pro-family and pro-marriage. I mean, she's really the package of support and love and sacrifice. And I know she has endured many things in her recent years, but she has her heart focused on our Lord. And she recognizes in the work that you do, the importance of helping you in the only ways that she can. And that's to manage the children in the household, to free you up enough to do what you have to do. And I think those Catholic media families, they have to operate by that kind of a code. I try my best to do a very similar thing for Greg, because I know what is required to pull off Catholic media. And I know that those creators have to get into some kind of an uninterrupted space, mental space, to do what they have to do. And it is a challenge at home when you have children everywhere and you still want to be a family, but you also have to balance work and sometimes it's not perfect. And sometimes, you know, people get offended, and I completely understand that, but it is very good work when you're trying to just bring Jesus to the people. So thank you for working so hard.
So Jason, what other Catholic media are you sort of is catching your attention lately? What are, you know, podcasts or videos or other things that, you know, because you're doing so much different media work, and a lot of times to continue to be inspired, you need to look to others for inspiration. What's inspiring you these days?
You know, it's funny. And if you asked me that 2 months ago, I'd have a long list. But the last 6-7 weeks, I've been really engulfed in this project. But in a general sense, your show is something I go to when I'm driving in and out of town. The Catholic Creatives, I'm part of this group, Catholic Creatives. And then often I'll just kind of check out some of the stuff that people are doing there. And I've got, some of the leaders, some of the Catholic media people that I really, really do admire would be Spiritual Studios. They do amazing stuff. I mean, they've done some cool stuff during this pandemic in terms of like high quality mass productions. But yeah, I mean, there's a few, there's been some really creative things. I mean, in particular in the pandemic, there has been some really interesting creative responses to this crazy pandemic, which has been inspirational on its own, you know. But I don't have any like a long list right now that's popping to my head. Probably because I'm lacking sleep and I'm so.
When you're awake, you're working on the conference.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
So the conference is happening this Saturday. It's going. It starts this Saturday.
Father's Day weekend.
People can register for it right now. Go to our website, gregandjennifer.com/331, so you can get the easy link to get over there. But when you sign up for it, they'll get the information. They'll know exactly where to go, and you've made it super easy for people to do that. But it's again, I don't know why you wouldn't want your kids to participate in this. And one of the, you know, you've long had this passion, as you said, for media for kids, Catholic media for kids. And even when we were in Denver, this was something that you really wanted to do. And I admit I had a lot of hesitation just because I had seen so much bad media, for bad Catholic media. When I say bad, not necessarily the content as much as just the way it was created. Like, I always struggled to get our kids to watch any of this stuff. But that idea of like, well, we can, then let's make it better. Then let's do it better. And you really have taken great steps to fix the problem of Catholic media for kids. So well done for that. I look forward to seeing it. I look forward to just continuing to watch what you're doing. And, you know, just Jason, again, from the perspective, again, I really appreciate the fact that God brought us together at one point, had us have the opportunity to work together. And I hope, you know, I learned as much working with you as, you know, you've said that you did, you know, working with me. I learned a tremendous amount. And a big part of what I learned, as I said, is to have a little bit more trust and hope in God and the kinds of things that He is putting in front of us. So well done on that. And I really hope that people listening to our show will go and check out your conference.
Awesome. Thank you, Greg and Jennifer. God bless you guys. Sincerely.
Again, go check out that website. If you go over to gregandjennifer.com/331, that link is there to the conference. You can sign up right now, as well as if you're using particular podcasters or podcatchers right now, if you look down, there might even be a link there looking at it on your phone. Just click that link. It'll take you over to the registration page as well. Sign up is free. If you have kids, you want them to take part of this. It's a great opportunity for them to see some high quality Catholic media aimed at children. So thanks to Jason for being on the program, for sharing with the world his talents, his desire to serve God. And that's it. As always, you can find show notes and links to everything that we talked about at gregandjennifer.com. You could subscribe to the podcast, leave your reviews over at iTunes, Google Play, wherever you get your stuff. And hey, if you want to support Rosary Army, this 501c3 nonprofit organization could use your help. You can get your own free all-twine knotted rosary from Rosary Army by going to rosaryarmy.com. You can get official Rosary Army t-shirts and more at willitsworks.com. Smile.amazon.com is a way to be able to support Rosary Army. Just sign on to smile.amazon.com and select Rosary Army as your charity of choice. And lastly, if you want to make a donation directly to Rosary Army, donorbox.org/Rosary Army. All donations made to Rosary Army are completely tax deductible. Donations to us, however, are not. And if you want to support Jennifer and I and the work that we do as podcasters and as Catholic media missionaries, you can do that by going to patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. All those donations go directly to our children and their food. Oh. patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. Thanks to all of you who continue to support our family and the work that we do by either patreon.com, PayPal.me/Greg and Jennifer for one-time tips, or by going over and buying swag at willitsworks.com. We love the fact that so many of you have continued to support us for so many years.
And we promise, as soon as rosaryarmy.com, the new website, is all done, I'm sure we will get busy producing brand new fun products that will be for sale on willitsworks, because we have all these ideas of things we want to create and share with the world. So stay tuned for a whole bunch of good stuff coming.
So until next time, you are awesome and you are not alone. We'll talk to you next week, folks.
All right. Be holy.
God bless.